you realize that our youth are growing up primarily in urban environments where we have few comprehensive environmental education programs that effectively relate youth to their environment. I'm Professor William Sapp, University of Michigan. It's important to keep in mind that someday our youth will be adult members of a community, and as citizens and voters, they're going to be asked to make decisions about that environment.
Bill Stepp was a passionate scholar and practitioner. Bill Stepp was a selfless individual who felt that empowering people was critical.
Oh, Bill was a phenomenal person. He was very genuine. He was very upbeat. He was exuberant. He was joyous.
He called everybody friend. I don't know if that was on purpose because he forgot our names, or if he was just overly generous and kind to everyone. He was an incredibly vivacious, bubbly, accommodating, warm, generous individual.
We first met when I was an undergrad, and Bill was working on his master's, and we met in a course at University of Michigan, Morphology of Fungi.
This partnership started on one of those fateful field trips. Bill was on one of these field trips, and Gloria was on a field trip looking for mushrooms, I believe. Mushrooms. And I think Bill said something to her, and she was dashing away, and she ripped her pants, climbing over a fence. I think Bill designed that whole thing. Because the next thing was that he gave us his jacket to protect her, and after that is history.
Bill was working on his PhD and was doing an environmental program with the Ann Arbor Public Schools. After he finished his PhD, he worked with the schools half-time and also with the university half-time.
New kinds of issues and problems were facing society at that time. And so it came upon us, do you take a term in conservation education and try to move it in some new directions, or take a new term and define that term and call it environmental education? To begin to think in terms of not only natural resources, but much more, the total environment. The questions of not just talking about things in descriptive terms, but also like in some of the issues that are facing society at that time, and begin to work people into those issues. Begin to think in terms of not just what the government can do, but what the citizens can do. To begin to think in terms of the behavioral patterns of how our attitudes are formed and how our attitudes change. Help people to begin to clarify their values, to help reach consistency in one's life. To begin to not only think about the environment, but also to begin to act in the environment.
The State Department came to Bill and said, would he like to go to UNESCO and help develop an environmental program internationally? He was excited about it, and he had wonderful people from different countries that came to UNESCO and worked with him. And then they went out into the field in each country, as many countries as they could. They did a lot of preparation before going to Tbilisi.
I specifically remember him talking about the process in Belgrade, which is when the experts were coming together to hammer out the wording of definitions and the goals and the objectives that would then be ratified by the government delegates in Tbilisi. So really the work and the thinking of what do we want happened prior to Tbilisi. And in Belgrade, there was a highly politically charged discussion about North versus South and investing in military versus investing in people, development versus developing. And at one point, people were hammering their fist and refusing to go on and, you know, staking their line in the sand, and it looked like the process was going to end before it ever started. Bill got pulled out of the room by one of the funders who said, you've got to shut this down. You've got to get control. You've got to bring people back together again. And Bill said, no, this is important. These voices need to be heard. They'll come around on their own. And so he let the process run until people got everything out of their system and then were able to agree on some key points that we all shared.
When he first got back, it was an honor to kind of be associated with a person with that kind of background and experience and what he had been able to accomplish. And the other thing I thought, which was really wonderful about him, was that he listened to students. So you had really good students coming to Michigan with a strong interest in social issues and environmental issues. And the classes were an opportunity to talk about ideas and influence ideas. So, you know, we basically saw environmental education evolve as a result of our being engaged in the classroom with Bill Stapp. So we listened to that, he incorporated ideas. He was a very kind person as well.
The first conference that I ever went to of NAAE, it was down in Blacksburg, Virginia. And what Bill did, as a faculty member, he was given a certain amount of travel funds. So instead of flying down there, you know, on his own and being happy, he actually turned his travel funds into a van from the university. And I believe Lori Mann drove her van too. So a bunch of us piled into these vans and drove all the way down there. Not only that, he let us all stay in his room, his hotel room. So there were probably, I don't know, like 10 people in this hotel room. Somebody, I believe it was Gus Medina, but he can correct me on that, tried to sleep in the tub, you know. He was always so willing to share. He didn't want necessarily the limelight. He often would push, you know, students up to the front of the room at a conference or whatever in order to share that and to expose students. And so he had a very nice way around him as a faculty member.
Well, he had a very open door policy that he was always there and usually didn't get his work done there unless he was teaching, and would do it at night because students were always coming in. And he never turned anyone away, and he always thought that was very important to be able to have a relationship with his students.
Well, a lot of other places were looking at nature study and conservation principles. Bill was talking about urban environmental education and bringing urban people in their communities and their environment into the discussion. He was interested in working with people wherever they were and however they defined their environment.
Everybody is an expert, he would say. And when we worked in inner city Detroit, at Hampton Middle School and Mumford High School, in neighborhoods that were under siege, that were he would always give them the feeling that they were important. They knew more about these neighborhoods than we did, and he did not push an environmental agenda on them. He let their own environmental agenda emerge from them, and by listening to them, he empowered them, and his action research and community problem-solving approach is still represents a model for environmental education that I think is very transformative, very relevant for today.
It's all part of a plan conceived by University of Michigan professor Bill Stapp.
Harvey, put the net down there and just step in front of it. Move your feet right and left and see if you can free any material right into the net.
For 40 years, Stapp has been working to get school children to care about the quality of our water and air. He's recognized internationally as the founder of environmental education. Recently, he was nominated for a Nobel Prize.
Okay, who's going to be the dripper?
Me.
Stapp's project is called the Global Rivers Environmental Education Network, known as GREEN. It's an educational program that puts kids in charge of water quality. For Bill Stapp, it's clearly a great day. The international leader who plans global environmental policies is just as thrilled as an eighth grader by the discovery of an insect.
Whoa, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, hey. Just found the prize of the day.
He was very proud of using rivers and water quality to link different communities. He strategically did that along the Jordan River with Arab and Israeli students, in South Africa, in Korea. He would find hotspots around the world to try to have youth work together to change the future. He used environmental education to promote peace and well-being, not just environmental quality. And that's still our challenge today. Mm-hmm.